Penguin Random House Audio presents Without Sanction by Don Bentley. Read for you by Scott Brick. To Ange, my beautiful believer. Surrender is not a ranger word. I will never leave a fallen comrade to fall into the hands of the enemy, and under no circumstances will I ever embarrass my country. Fifth stanza of the U.S. Army Ranger Creed. You do not realize that it is better for you that one man die for the people than that the whole nation perish. John chapter 11, verse 50, New International Version. Prologue. Aleppo, Syria. The front door split from its frame with an ominous crack as sunlight flooded the room. For Fazil Malouf, time seemed to stand still. The afternoon's golden light played across Yana's features, spilling over her thick eyelashes and the dusting of freckles covering her cheeks. In that moment, there were no civil wars, senseless killings, or black-clad jihadis attempting to force their way into Fazil's tiny apartment. In that moment, only his wife and the squirming bundle clutched to her chest truly existed. And then, that moment was gone. Inside, Fazil said, guiding Yana and their daughter into the apartment's safe room with one hand while gripping a pistol with the other. I'll get the beacon. Fazil, Yana said, reaching toward him as her dark eyes filled with tears. Quickly, my love, Fazil said, stepping out of reach of her trembling fingers. Just like we practiced. Fazil turned on his heel and raced toward the kitchen and salvation. Snatching the coffee pot from the cluttered counter, he found the recessed button beneath the handle and stabbed downward. The plastic broke beneath his fingers as a hidden switch was depressed. A heartbeat later, the carafe vibrated, signifying that the distress signal had been transmitted. He'd done it. Help was on the way. Dropping the pot, Fazil sighted down the pistol's stubby barrel as the first jihadi burst through the splintered front door, sweeping the room with his AK-47. Fazil jerked the pistol's trigger just as the jihadi's rifle belched fire. An unseen fist hammered Fazil's shoulder. He stumbled, the pistol slipping. Gritting his teeth, Fazil steadied his grip and fired again. And again. And again. Fazil wasn't a soldier, but he didn't have to be. He'd triggered the beacon. The American would come. Just like he'd promised. 1. Austin, Texas, 3 months later. The toddler smiled at me from over her mother's shoulder, her eyes sparkling. A pudgy hand snuck past the tumbling curls that framed her face, and her tiny fingers waved. I didn't wave back. Not because I didn't know the little girl. I knew her quite well. Her name was Abir, Arabic for beautiful, and the raven-haired cutie more than lived up to her name. No, I was ignoring her for a different reason altogether. Like her mother and father, Abir had been dead for almost 3 months. But that didn't stop me from seeing her. I closed my eyes, fighting the urge to return her wave as I had so many times before in the front room of her family's tiny Syrian apartment. Abir's laugh had been almost as intoxicating as her grin. Even now, it took everything within me not to smile on the off chance that the dead toddler, visible only to me, might break her silence and gift me with a giggle in return. But I didn't smile, and I didn't wave, because men who interacted with imaginary children attracted attention. Austin, Texas might be the self-professed home of the weird, but I had no desire to make the acquaintance of the TSA men and women who worked at this airport. So I tried to ignore Abir, and the shakes started right on schedule. The trembling began with a barely noticeable twitch in my left index finger, but left unchecked, the twitching wouldn't stay barely noticeable for long. Taking a deep breath, I curled the offending finger and two of its brethren into the opening chord of Take It Easy by the Eagles, picturing my hand wrapped around the smooth neck of my knockoff Gibson acoustic. Don't get me wrong. I liked newer music too, but Eagles songs had deceptively simple chord structures that even amateurs could quickly master, as founding members Don Henley and Glenn Frey had proven with hit after hit, sometimes greatness really was masked by simplicity. How they looking, sir? With a start, I shifted my attention from the phantom toddler to Jeremiah the shoeshine man, and then to my gleaming Ariat cowboy boots. The airport boasted quite a few shoeshine artists, but only one who'd acquired his skills at the polishing school of hard knocks, Marine Boot Camp. Fine job, Jeremiah. Thank you, sir, Jeremiah said, adjusting his ball cap over tufts of patchy white hair. That'll be $8. Jeremiah's cap was fire engine red with the words Vietnam Veteran emblazoned across the front in yellow stitching. Above the words hung an embroidered image of his Vietnam service ribbon. That was it. No unit designations, special forces tabs, or pins denoting previous ranks or medals. Just a faded red hat announcing that, unlike so many of his wayward generation, Jeremiah had answered his country's call to service. Though we'd shared numerous shines, Jeremiah had never once spoken about his time in Vietnam. But I knew that he'd been there. One, because he refused to talk about his service, and two, because he had the look. With Jeremiah, the look manifested as an occasional stare into nothingness, a physical reaction to a mental trauma. In other words, Jeremiah's eyes had seen things that his mind wished he could somehow unsee. I knew the feeling. I took a 10 and a 5 from my wallet and pressed the bills into Jeremiah's gnarled brown fingers. That's too much, Mr. Drake, Jeremiah said with a frown, the expression highlighting the web of wrinkles furrowing his ebony face. For the 1,000th time, I said, call me Matt. And the extra money isn't charity. It's to rent your chair for a spell. Jeremiah shined my boots twice a week, every Monday and Friday at 9 a.m., and had done so for the past 6 weeks. Even so, we still had a variant of this conversation every time I sat down in one of the four high-backed chairs he called an office. In a way, the normality associated with our routine was comforting. Some people had service dogs, a shrink on retainer, or a medicine cabinet stocked with pills. I had a 70-year-old African-American shoeshine artist and a second-hand guitar. I guess I was doing pretty well, all things considered. Them shakes ain't good, Mr. Drake, Jeremiah said, pointing a shoe-polish-stained finger at my trembling hand. Or not. The spasms had crept past my fingers, and now the muscles in my forearms were dancing. I mentally switched songs from Take It Easy to Ants Marching, trading the simple G-D-C progression for the series of vexing bar chords that Dave Matthews floated across so effortlessly. No luck. If I didn't stop the cycle soon, the tremors would evolve into something mirroring a full-fledged seizure, and that couldn't happen. Not now. Because the arrivals and departures monitor hanging over Jeremiah's right shoulder showed that the direct flight from San Diego had just arrived at Gate 5. In less than 10 short minutes, my reason for sitting at this airport every Monday and Friday would cross the busy passenger thoroughfare in front of me, heading to Gate 9 and her connecting flight to Reagan. A ticket for that same flight rested in my right front pocket. Maybe today would be the day I finally used it. Mr. Drake. It's Matt, Jeremiah. Matt. Mr. Drake. I think the Lord has a word for you. I looked from the monitor to Jeremiah. This was unexplored territory. In the 40 or so days we'd known each other, our conversations had never progressed past the safety of the superficial. Despite my non-regulation length hair and scruffy beard, Jeremiah had seemed to intuit that he and I shared something of a history. Maybe it was because my broad shoulders and scarred knuckles seemed at odds with my carefully cultivated ragamuffin appearance. Or maybe the look on my face mirrored his. Either way, Jeremiah knew that he and I belonged to the same fraternity, though I was probably at least 40 years, Jeremiah.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.